This is Pete Proj broadcasting from Meat Space.
If you're watching this, you're either here to see a few bits from Digitiser Live, or you don't know what Digitiser Live is, or what Digitiser is, or what Teletext is. Look, for those of you who want to see Paul Gannon spewing water over Mr. Biffo, skip ahead to this time. For those of you who need a primer, strap in as I delve into Teletext history. In the late 1960s, television broadcasting went to colour in the UK. It was more than just a rainbow on your screen, as the resolution increased significantly, with the amount of lines going from 405 to 625. That's 100 more than American television, which always looked a bit blurry and smeary to us lot in Europe. We never got to see all 625 lines filled with the picture though. The boxy CRT televisions of the era had a frame shape that was shaped like a bloated rectangle. Plus, for technical reasons, some of the unseen lines were reserved for standards information that your telly needed to produce a stable picture. In the early 1970s, an engineer came up with a proposal to send binary data on six of these lines so that the farming community in rural Britain could view news and statistics on agriculture. The BBC took this idea on board, but sensibly decided to dedicate it to general news and information. The resulting pages look very low-tech to us now, like a magazine typing listing for an Acorn Electron, but it was futuristic at the time and appeared rapidly on the screen. The BBC's service was known as CFAX, ITV quickly followed by establishing Oracle. Your television set needed a teletext decoder to view these pages, and from the late 1970s, tellies with built-in teletext arrived on the market. Teletext is a one-way system, being from television transmitters, so it's not like you could leave rude comments on the pages. The only method of interactivity would be the authors appealing to people to write in using actual pens and paper and stamps and that, or maybe a telephone call. Before the World Wide Web started to be available to homes around the mid-1990s, teletext was kind of like a primitive internet. With no 24-hour news channels, this was our way of checking in on news stories at almost any time. You could tell if there's a football fan in the household because the numbers 302 would be worn down on the remote. CFAX page 302 was a religion to football fans, dedicated to late breaking news about clubs and player transfers. You could probably say that Radio 5 and the Sky Sports News Channel is the natural evolution of this. So how does Digitiser factor into all of this? Well, in 1993, the ITV network was shaken up as a few of the broadcasting franchises were terminated and replaced by newcomers. Everyone knows about Thames, but one of the lesser known casualties was Oracle, which was switched off in favour of a service calling itself Teletext. Yes, that's about as generic a name as you can get for the medium. The company was an offshoot from the Daily Mail, broadcasting pages across ITV and Channel 4. Like its predecessor Oracle, advertising, mainly from holiday companies, brought in income. Paul Rose was hired for the graphics side of things, piecing together those neon mosaics, but also managed to convince his managers that the service needed a computer games section. Paired with writer Tim Moore, the two of them came up with Digitiser, a daily updated section of Teletext that reviewed games and brought us gaming news. The thing that distinguished Digitiser was its left-field surreal humour. Physical magazines about computer games were no stranger to this, with the pages of Your Sinclair and Amiga Power littered with daft in-jokes and flights of whimsy. Yet with Digitiser, the offbeat comedy was there in abundance, littering the pages with recurring characters. Sometimes there'd be more of that than actual gaming content. And yet none of this put off the readership. It's estimated that up to 1.5 million readers tuned in. That's around 15 times the size of a good-selling games magazine. Digitiser had a long spell in the age where Sega and Nintendo consoles dominated, and right into the early PlayStation era. After the 9/11 attacks, the tourism industry underwent some turmoil, and so the primary income for Teletext shrunk massively. Paul Rose, who was Mr. Biffo, hung up his keyboard in 2003 and went on to be a screenwriter for television. In a world where everyone's got a black rectangle of internet in their pockets, Teletext is pretty much a dead thing. Here, in the 21st century, it's become obsolete, like typesetting, fax machines, and prosperity. Yet the cult-like appeal of Digitiser means it's fondly remembered, and Paul Rose resurrected it as an entertaining blog in 2014. Through crowdfunding, Paul was able to make a surreal comedy sci-fi series called Found Footage in 2017. Even more popular was the plan to make Digitiser as an online TV series. Another successful crowdfunding campaign brought in Digitiser the Show, hosted by Mr. Biffo alongside four prominent YouTube gaming personalities. For the first time outside the Teletext medium, the mad characters of Digitiser could be seen in real life, leading to the chaos going on in the studio. Plus, there are plenty of well-loved guests from the retro gaming community and Top Hat Gaming Man. You can see all six episodes for now on YouTube. The end result is like an anarchic Saturday morning show. A promise in one of the crowdfunding tiers was a live episode in an actual theatre, and that's what led me to the Harrow Arts Centre on July 20th, armed with this ancient, battered, handheld camcorder. Digitizer is held in such high esteem that some fans put on the free three-hour celebration before the show, which exhibited the technology at Teletext, prolific Digitizer contributors and fans, plus miscellaneous stuff from retro gaming enthusiasts. And if you weren't into that, you could just mingle with like-minded fans in the car park with drink from the local supermarket. Now that's what I call glamour. Digitizer Live was filmed in full, and I'm not going to spoil that. What I've got for you now are 12 minutes of happenings from that day.
So this is Digitizer Live. It's a car park in Harrow.
Oh, raise a glass for you, Bronk.
That's the entire show, that's all it is. So what do you make of it so far, Mr. Guy Gigapunk?
Oh, it's rubbish, isn't it?
Do you have a grandfather called Terrapunk, or is that the secret? I don't know. Petapunk. Yeah, where do we go from here?
Well, thank you for coming. This is Digitizer Live. 26 years.
Still on the train somewhere in England is Stuart Ash. Stuart isn't able to be with us at the moment, so there's a packet of biscuits instead.
Alcohol.
It does all sorts of stuff.
Now you're missing one of your teeth, Fats Al.
Yeah! Who's to blame for that?
You've got a meth addict problem.
Oh, yeah! Yeah! Listen, Paul, I am neat!
Thank you for that. I donated a couple of cans, that's it, really.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Yeah, that's, right,
that's my channel, Weekend Lolly Gagger. I basically do music, travel, food, games.
Games, that, we're on with that. Music and travel and food, I especially hate. I don't even eat food.
But I basically do everything and anything. All a bit of fun. Movies, music, you name it, I do a little bit of it.
Met people I've known online for 15 years and spoken to them for the first time today.
This isn't my clipboard. My clipboard's got my funny comments on. I'll try and remember my funny comments. Why are we missing two people? Oh, Octavius!
It's early. It's only about 5:30. We're going to hate each other by the end of the night.
You recently starred in your second film, I believe.
Technically, it's not out yet. Buy it yet. Don't get too excited.
Tell me, how difficult was the audition process for landing the lead role in Passions in the Polybius Heights?
F***ing Simon Pegg turned up. To cut a long story short, I cried until they gave it to me.
What are you expecting from tonight's show?
I literally don't know. I've just been told to come along. I'm on stage.
I know you're part of it, but you genuinely don't know.
I 100% do not know what's going to happen.
That's pure.
I've just been in there and seen some of the weird shit they're showing up on the screen, and it's a bit like, ooh, you guys are in for some stuff. Like, I generally don't know what I'm doing. No.
That is
There's
pure
Kim right there as well. I don't know what Kim's going to be doing either.
That's enough, isn't it?
What are you expecting from tonight's show?
I've only just got here. How long
is that? None of us have been briefed. Absolutely none of us have been briefed.
Right.
I don't know, frankly speaking, if there's going to be anything to do with prawns.
Tell you what, though, my pipe's all blocked up. And so is my nose, so I can't smell which pipe is blocked with what substance.
That's the one, yeah.
Chai, hideaway, Bunty. My favourite DC Thompson girls comic. Made it. Then you can do your libelous thing about Bob Holness or whatever. I have no idea.
Let's get kind of big Sonic fans up here to play this. I'd ask for volunteers, but we've already pre-selected them. DJ Slow and Suze Kemner, where are you? You're out there. Questions. That's Pockety Mock again. Here they are. Oh, you're going behind here, are you?
Liver.
Does my radio mic working yet? No. Okay. So, big Sonic the Hedgehog fans, you're sharing the mic, so. Yeah. But when did that start?
When I was seven. 10 years ago.
Down for you.
When I was seven as well.
Really?
There you go.
Were you seven at the same time?
Yeah.
We're celebrating Teletext as a stage show, which is like ballet featuring the Test Guard Girl.
Bring it on! Come on, take him down.
Twitter's Squiddy UK and JKL.
JKL.
I could picture it in my head. And the door's being manned by Becky from Trista Bites.
Right, the reason why I want to keep this is because it's a wonderful thing. Because the best thing about the Action 52 is that there's nothing good about it. It's one of the worst games you can ever hope to play. It was released in 1991 by some bloke who basically realised that he could make loads of money out of bootlegging video games. He got funded like £1 million by investors. He got some students, chucked him in a room for 3 months and said, right, make this. Sing you a song. Hey! And it's not about poo.
What is poo? A lot.
But I'm going to need someone to help me out with it. The song that I literally just finished writing 5 minutes before curtain up. Please welcome to the stage, Lobstalgia Nerd.
I'm a lobster, aren't I?
Would you like some small babies?
Thank you.
This old crap battered. Look how battered this camcorder is. Blimey. It's that shite.
Quite expensive. Make your own Blair Witch.
Oh,
Claire!
Hello, Claire.
Oh, it's my best friend.
Hello.
Peter String Theory.
Yes. I may or may not be dead, but we don't know.
We just don't know. Dancer of choice.
Come on, love.
Come on. Here we go. Oh, she's sexy. Right. Oh, my God. Sexy dancing.
Two Charlies.
This guy here.
Did that go the way you wanted it to?
I could have done with it being about 40 minutes shorter than it was.
More.
But, you know, that's it. We didn't expect it to go to plan at all. And it kind of almost did, in a sort of funny sort of way. So, I think we're all relatively happy. I haven't seen anyone else since it yet. I haven't had a chance to catch up, so I shouldn't.
Octavius is out there still.
Is she?
Yeah. So, you got it from teletext to a stage show.
Yeah.
Apart from Digitizer, what else from teletext could work as a stage show? Don't say the news.
Well, I think about a bamboozle hardcore new stage show.
Okay. Yeah,
that would be better.
We're in the West End, Soho.
That would be better than what we just saw. Dare I say it? And that was the first of many excursions for Reheat Pixels into MeatSpace. But don't forget, we're primarily a reviews channel, and you can see some of our reviews on this network.